Well, it's been a long time coming, but here finally is part 6 of the top 100 Hubble image series, and today we're going to be looking at some of the most bizarre images Hubble has taken. And when I say bizarre, I'm talking about images that have just made me say out loud, what the... So without further ado, here's number 29 of the series, NGC 6960, or the Veil Nebula. This astonishingly coloured web of filaments is in fact a small portion of the Witch's Broom Nebula, which in turn is part of the huge nearby nebula known as Cygnus Loop. Cygnus Loop is only 1,500 light-years away from us, very close by astronomical standards. It is a giant supernova remnant, or the remains of a dead star that exploded about 10,000 years ago. Since then, it has expanded to cover an area that is as wide as 6 full moons in the night sky. Sadly though, this nebula is also quite faint and is not visible with the naked eye. As always with Hubble images, the bright colours here are representative of the ionised atoms in the image. Blue is oxygen, green is sulfur, and red is hydrogen. The ionization of the atoms comes from the shockwave of the supernova, blasting debris 600,000 kilometers per hour into surrounding gas, heating it to millions of degrees Celsius. As this gas cools, it releases wavelengths of light that are then picked up by Hubble. To me, this nebula is a masterpiece. I'm not one to be able to analyze art, perhaps some of you can do better in the comments, but the colors are just so vibrant and the filaments are so intricate, I'm just blown away by this image. Number 30, NGC 1275. Now, this is a really odd looking galaxy. I'm much more used to seeing pretty bands in a spiral galaxy, or at least galaxies that are somewhat symmetrical. These filamentary structures here, though, are just randomly going wherever they please, seemingly disconnected from their parent galaxy. Well, it seems disconnected because this part of the image here is in fact a separate galaxy, roughly 200,000 light years in front of the larger background galaxy. The smaller galaxy is known as a high velocity system, speeding towards the background galaxy at 3,000 kilometers a second. At one point in the future, there's going to be an almighty collision between the two. Going back to the filaments, scientists are puzzled as to why and how they exist without either warming up, dissipating, or forming stars. It's thought this can only be due to the supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy, a monster black hole at 800 million solar masses. The black hole may be able to suspend the gas in the filaments using its huge magnetic field, which, according to models, have survived for 100 million years. The galaxy itself is massive, one of the biggest types that we know of. This image is about 260,000 light years across, and NGC 1275 is found 237 million light years away. Number 31, IC 2497, or Honey's Vorwerk. The galaxy itself looks normal enough, but what's all this green at the bottom of the image? Now this explanation is seriously bizarre. The green blobs, or Honey's Vorwerk, which means Honey's object in Dutch, is the visible part of a gas streamer that stretches 300,000 light years around the galaxy. I say visible part because what is thought to be a flashlight-like beam of light from the galaxy's core has illuminated this section. This flashlight is thought to have come from a quasar, a first for this series. Very basically, a quasar is a supermassive black hole that is emitting an absolutely huge amount of electromagnetic radiation in all the different wavelengths. We're talking 10 to the power 41 watts, thousands of times greater than the whole Milky Way combined. In this image, it is theorized that a smaller galaxy bumped into IC 2497, causing a lot of gas to fall into its supermassive black hole. This sudden increase in gas falling into the black hole causes it to turn on as a quasar, emitting a beam of light like cone onto Honey's Vorwerk, gas also streams away from the parent galaxy, impacting Hani's Vorwerk, triggering star formation. This star formation is actually why the tips of this gas cloud are a different color. The gas itself is green because in this image it is ionized oxygen atoms. The quasar has since shut down, so it's not visible anymore, but the light is still reflecting off Hani's Vorwerk as we speak. The quasar is the closest one that we know of, although it is still 730 million light years away. The most active one is 1.7 billion light years away. Number 31, and oh wow, this is the twin Jet Nebula, or PNM29. And although I've seen this image lots in the research for this video, I'm still amazed that there is something like this in space right now. This is a planetary nebula, and it is the result of what happens when one star in a binary star system ejects its outer shell. Astronomers theorize that the gravity of one star pulls some of the gas from the surface of the other and flings it into a thin, dense disk extending into space. This time-lapse sequence shows a jet move within the structure over the course of several years. It's this jet which is thought to give the nebula its shape. The star which ejected its shell is now a cooling off red giant, which eventually will become a white dwarf. The twin Jet Nebula is about 2,100 light years away from us. Number 32 is a giant space bubble known as NGC 7635. To me, this looks like a giant marble many light years across. Somehow, you just don't expect to find bubbles in space, but here is one and it is gorgeous. The area is known as an H2 region, or a star-forming area. This whole nebula around the bubble is in fact a molecular cloud, which is cold gas and dust. The bubble itself is caused by stellar wind from this massive and hot star in the center of the bubble, pushing the gas and dust in the nebula away from the star. But the molecular cloud is resisting with its own internal pressure. What we are witnessing here is a pushing contest between the molecular cloud and the stellar wind. The edge of the bubble is ionized atoms of the cloud, the front line of where this battle is taking place. Put into this perspective, the star is trying to free itself from the nebula by blasting it away. In a few million years, we will see what becomes of this battle. NGC 7635 is about 10,000 light years away. Number 33, and we are coming to an exceptionally odd looking galaxy called NGC 1512. Now this image is really pixelated because I've zoomed in a lot, but this looks like it could be the whole galaxy, right? Well, it's not. Zooming out reveals this is not the only part of the galaxy, it's got another outer ring all the way out here. This by itself looks weird enough. You have a halo of stars around the inner ring, which dims the further you go out to this outer ring. You also have these two bars of dust seemingly connecting the rings together, and it looks like a giant eyeball. But wait, there's more. There's a neighbor galaxy called NGC 1510 right here next to it. Or is it next to it? Zooming out again reveals we are still only looking at half of NGC 1512 in that last image. It is crazy, the galaxy has another section of spiral arms outside of the outer ring, which means the smaller galaxy is actually within the bigger one, and they are really in the process of merging. This has been going on for 400 million years already, and explains why the outer arms are so extended, and why the galaxy looks as weird as it does. Eventually, the smaller galaxy will merge with the bigger one, and they will become one. NGC 1512 is about 39 million light years away from us. Number 34, and the last image for this episode. Now what do you think this could be? The birth of a star, maybe? Well, while it's not known with certainty, it is thought this spectacular image is in fact a star shortly before it ejects its outermost shell into a planetary nebula. What we are looking at here is the Egg Nebula, or a protoplanetary nebula. This stage of a star's life is short, only lasting for a few thousand years, plus it's very dim, which means there are only a few of them that we know of. What you will notice is this disk of dust surrounding the central star, and where there are gaps in the disk, the star shines through, like spotlights, illuminating the nebula. The onion layers in the surrounding nebula are thought to be parts of the outer layer of the dying star that have been ejected every couple of hundred years. The nebula's layers only reach out for a tenth of a light year, so this object really is small. The Egg Nebula is found 2,000 light years away. Now, the way that I have been doing this is going through the top 100 zip file on the Hubble website, but they have since updated this file since I started the series, so now I'm picking my favourites until I get to 100. If you are a patron and want to pick which images get included, I'm going to create a post which you can comment the links to. This is one way I want to say thanks for supporting my channel by getting the community more involved. Another way of supporting my channel is through Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community with over 20,000 classes in design, business, technology, and more. As some of you may know, I've been playing around with thumbnails on YouTube, and typography is a big part of that. With premium membership on Skillshare, I have unlimited access to high-quality classes on lots of must-know topics, including learning about the impact of typography on viewers. I've been checking out Jason Santamaria, who has a great course explaining the impact of typography and how to apply it for my own needs. Is there something you've always wanted to learn about? Something you need to get more proficient at? Then join the millions of students already learning on Skillshare today. An annual subscription gets the price under $10 a month, but for the first 500 of you, when you sign up, you can get 2 months of premium access to Skillshare for free if you use this link in the description. Thanks for watching. Doing this video has reawakened my love for Hubble, so no doubt you'll be seeing more of this kind of thing in the future. If you like the video, be sure to subscribe so you don't miss out anything in the future. All the best, and I'll see you next time.